So remember, every time we go back to Trading My Sorrows, big, big, big. And get them all to do it the same way. Let's all everybody. Yeah.
Oh. Whoa.
I'm just gonna say Ember, this year is a professional student artist.
Go, go, go.
Yo, yo, hello!
Welcome! Woo!
Bienvenidos a Pagabar!
Welcome to International Chapel!
Okay, I encourage you, you can find your seat. If you can sit on the front, it would be great so that everyone can have room so we feel close too. It would be great, okay? Yeah. Welcome, welcome. All right. It's so good to see everyone here. And today, I'm Daryl.
And I'm Nicole. And we are this year's international reps. We're so excited to be representing you internationals. Can I get a hand for the internationals here? Woo! Come on.
Yeah. This is International Chapel, the climax of International Week. We've been celebrating many cultures from different countries, and it is the time to exalt the name of our all name and the Lord of our all Lords, Jesus Christ. It's gonna be so exciting. Yeah.
But before that, we have a couple announcements that we wanna share with you guys.
We have Freedom Encounter tonight, leading until tomorrow, so make sure you come tonight. And then, not only Freedom Night, tonight we also have First Love at 9 p.m. Make sure you're there. We're going to pray for nations too, still international theme. It's going to be powerful, powerful night. Yes. What else do we have?
We also have Thanksgiving coming up. Woo, woo, woo. That means no school, MCA, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, PBC, Thursday and Friday, no school. That also means that if you are not gonna be here during the weekend, please get your forms in to Jason so that you can leave, and curfew is extended till 12:30. And also, if you have no place to go for Thanksgiving, please let one of the dorm leaders know. We would love to get you connected with somebody.
Right, that's good. And then, PPC online registration for spring semester is open, and register early if you're taking classes online. And then we have home PPC basketball game next Saturday, November 25th at 7:30 p.m. So make sure, check it out. It's gonna be great. Yeah.
And now we're gonna go into giving life. So for giving life this week, I wanted to do something a little bit different and give back to the missionaries that Manor House has sent out. As an international student, I know that it can be very, very uncomfortable to leave your home and to leave your comfortability, to leave your family and go out and do the Lord's work. But these these missionaries have gone out and they're risking their lives and they're working with different people to go and do the Lord's work. And so if you could step out into your uncomfortability for a little bit, just as they did, and give a little bit back to them, to thank them for what they're doing, to thank them for reaching out to the nations, to thank them for taking the step that maybe we haven't been called to yet. So, yeah. And next up, I want to introduce the PBC dance team.
Welcome to International Chapel,
Let's
everybody!
Go!
Everybody stand up. Woo! Can we give it one more time for our amazing dance team?
Come on.
Give them one more clap, one more
shout.
Hey, we're not done yet. If you want to worship, if you want to dance, why don't you come up here to the front? I know there's more of you. Come on, MCA, if you want to come and party. Best chapel of the year right here. Come on. More of you, come up to the front. Come up to the front. All right. Now, let's all do this together. We're going to go to the right, to the left. Here we go. That's good. A little more. Come on, everybody. Let's sing this.
I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
I'm trading my sickness.
I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
Abandoned, stressed out but not destroyed. I am blessed beyond the curse, for his promise will endure.
the center of this day. Be the center of our lives. Be the center of this international week, Lord. At the center of it all, Jesus, at the center of it all, from beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus, Jesus, come on, say it with me. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. that it's all about you. How many of you know that it's all about Jesus? It's just about Jesus. So I just want you to declare this one more time with me. We're gonna make Jesus the center of this meeting. We're gonna make Jesus the center of our life one more time.
Right.
If he's not the center of your life right now, just close your eyes and say, Jesus, be the center of my life.
Jesus, be the center of my life.
I need you. I need you in my family. I need you in my life. I need you in my job. I need you in every single place I go. Jesus, be the center. Be the center. Be the center. Jesus, be the center. Just be the center. Be the center. Be the center. It's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you. From my heart. From my heart to the heavens. Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. And from my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. It's all about you.
Yes, it's all about you.
Jesus, be the center of it all. Jesus, be the center of it all. From beginning to it's always been you, Jesus.
Come on, say Jesus.
Jesus.
Everybody say
Jesus. Jesus.
No one like you.
Jesus. Oh, Jesus.
Jesus, yes, Jesus.
Well, let's pray. I'm just gonna bow down. Would you guys please join me with lifting your hands? The Heavenly Father God, we thank you for your blood that covered all the bells, that the Gentiles can come, then the every nations can come. They can be in the new covenant. Thank you for your blood. Thank you that we all get to be here from different nations, from different countries. The Heavenly Father, I pray for Egypt, God. that you built your church there, dear Heavenly Father. That you move there, dear Heavenly Father, strongly, dear Heavenly Father God. That you breathe on this nation, dear Heavenly Father God. That the deception, the lies, dear Heavenly Father, that this people living at, dear Heavenly Father, that will be broken in the name of Jesus, God. God, I pray that there is hope, dear Heavenly Father God, for these people. It's an Islamic country. There is hope for these people. The Heavenly Father God, I pray for the not just my nation, but the areas there, the Heavenly Father. The war is going on, the Heavenly Father. It's very close from home, God. I pray for a peace for this piece of land, the Heavenly Father, dear God. I pray that rivers will flow from Egypt, the Heavenly Father, to Africa, the Heavenly Father. That your light will shine in Africa, the Heavenly Father, God. That everybody will know the truth, the Heavenly Father, God. Thank you for your blood. Thank you for your word.
Lord, we pray, we come to you, Lord Jesus, to beg you, Lord, for a new wake up, for a new awakening of your spirit, Lord. For Europe, Lord, that Europe will wake up again, Lord, and will see your movement, Lord. That Europe will wake up and as it was in the beginning of centuries, Lord. That Jesus will move again and people will be fearful and will have zeal for your word, Lord Jesus. I pray that you will start moving again, the youth in Europe, Lord. Even if the youth is little, even if a young adult is little, Lord, you will put a fire and a passion on them, Lord, to bring back Christianity again, to conquer and overcome all the hardened hearts that is being they've been living there, Lord Jesus. We pray, Lord, that as also in Europe, Lord, we pray for Africa. We pray that the last of the world will be the first in heaven, Lord. That those nations that are being neglected by the world, Lord, those are your people. Those are nations that you care, Lord Jesus, and that you will send people there. That you will rise up leaders, Lord, that will speak with authority. Will be speak with authority against false teachers. False doctrines, Lord Jesus. And the fear of the Lord will come again to this land, Lord Jesus. And the fear and zeal of your word, Lord, for the sake of the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Jesus, God, I just pray, God, for Asia, God, and Australia. Jesus, God, people are lost, God. God, that they need you, Jesus. God, the lost sheep, God. They're crying out. So Jesus, I pray, God, that you would just meet them, Jesus. God, that you would just come, God, and encounter, God, the people of Asia, God, and the people of Australia. So Jesus, I just pray, God, that you would pour your spirit out, Jesus. Pour out your spirit, God, upon all flesh, God, all men, God, all women, God, all children, God, that you would just pour your spirit out, Jesus. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, God. Lord, I pray, God, that you would just anoint, God, the people, God, even here, God, people who are called to Asia, God, or Australia. Lord, I just pray a fresh anointing, God, upon them, God. God, that they would go, God, with your spirit, God, and they would go with your grace. So, Holy Spirit, God, we invite you just to come. Come rest on us, God. In Jesus' name, come.
Let us all be filled with reverence and fear of the Lord. For there is power in our prayer. This is not a performance. This is real. This is heartbeat of the Father to pray for people that are lost. People need to return to Lord Jesus. If you are sitting down or wherever, I ask you to in a posture of reverence. Lord, as we see the world, and especially America, we fix our attention on that country, on the land that we stood right now. I pray that you may open the eyes of our hearts, that we may see the glory once again. That was once found in truth will forever walk in truth. Open the eyes of our heart, Lord Jesus. Open the eyes of our hearts. I ask you, lift up your song, prayer. I'm not praying for you. I'm not saying for you. We pray together. We pray together. Lift up your voice. Lift up your hand. Yes, Lord, we intercede for America. This is your country. And this is our country, actually. We live here. We love this place because God loves this place. Let's lift up our voice. Let's pray. Let's intercede. Lord Jesus, we pray. Break every chains. Open the eyes of the hearts of men that they may see, Lord Jesus, see the cross. The church will be returning to the cross of Christ in the name of Jesus. Oh, for the end goal of everything that exists is to exalt the name of Jesus. Exalt the name of Jesus. Exalt your name. Exalt your the name of Jesus.
Oh,
I have the biggest privilege to present the speaker tonight. She is a great woman of God who is constantly led in the Holy Spirit and has been a great example in my life. And I get the privilege of calling her my aunt. So this is very personal to me. And I wanted to say thank you to her for being such a good example throughout my whole life of what a woman of the Lord looks like, and for supporting me in everything that I've done. Because sometimes it's not easy, but it means a lot to me that you're here and that you're here to speak to the internationals as well. So without further ado, Miriam Turley.
Not fair. I've got a microphone. I've got one. Not fair. She made me cry. That's not how this is supposed to go. But thank you, everyone. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Yeah, please go back to your seats. That's not the way this is supposed to start. Glad I brought Kleenex. And before I jump in, and I am honored that I get to share with you guys this morning, I do feel just a word. I mean, it is International Chapel that God put a word in my heart for you guys. And because it is International Chapel, I feel I have a word for TCKs. And if you don't know what a TCK is, TCKs are third culture kids. And third culture kids are the children of immigrants. I am one of those. When I was 12 years old, I moved to Canada for 7 years, and then I went back to El Salvador, but I am a child of immigrants. TCKs are the children of missionaries. So I know we have some TCKs here too. Literally, my home is the definition of a TCK, because I'm a TCK, I'm the daughter of immigrants, and my husband is the son of missionaries. So I mean, we're TCKs. But I have a word for you guys. If that's you, you don't need to do anything, but just receive this. Because see, a TCK sometimes lives in a home where two or three languages are spoken. And some of you guys received even a word saying that you're slow to speak. And there was a label put on you that you were behind or you were too slow. But this morning, God has something to clarify in your life. See, you were given a special grace. Because TCKs don't fully belong in one culture. We move from one to the next, and we're not 100% in either one. And see, there are bridge builders, but TCKs are bridge runners, because we go from one culture to the next. Can I remind you what Paul said about that? He said, I can become a Jew to the Jew, and I can become a Greek to the Greek, just so the gospel that's spread and it's heard from in more groups of people. And so if you're a TCK, can I tell you something? Or even if you have a calling for the nations, see, the picture God gave me is of a marathon runner. And they begin in such a humble place, kneeling down, hands to the floor, but they get ready to be launched. And I feel God is saying, I'm going to remove off of you any mindset, any label that was said and spoken over you, that you were slow, that you were not enough, that you couldn't fit in this culture or this other culture, because God is saying, I gave you specific grace for today. I prepare you for the season. I prepare you for this culture. God has given you a specific and unique grace. And others may look at it as a disadvantage, but you will realize that it's a unique grace and calling on your life. And from this day forward, there will be no shame. There will be no label that you were slow to start. You were set up by God for this season. I think God has orchestrated so much for such a time as this. And see, some of us When you ask me, where's home? It's a tough question for me. I was born in El Salvador. I lived 7 formative years in Canada, and I have lived the longest in the U.S. out of any other country. Where's home? Because of nostalgia, I say El Salvador. And see, some of you, and I found it so interesting as I was preparing for this, that the president of PBC, he came to Portland as an international student. I don't think that's a coincidence. I don't think that it's a coincidence that the vice president of Portland Bible College, where's home? Yeah, exactly. He's lived in 3 different countries too. I don't think that's a coincidence. I don't think that Koya was interceding for the nations even before she went. I don't think that's a coincidence. I definitely do not think that's a coincidence that your campus pastors, Jason, where's home? Exactly, yes. I do not think that that's a coincidence either. God is up to something, Portland Bible College. God is doing something new in this season. And Angie Prosser, she marked me because it was when they presented to the leadership that they wanted to be sent out. She talked about how Ken brought her currency from different countries and how the nations were in her heart. And I said, me too. Me too. And I don't think that it's a coincidence that there's such a sensitivity for the nations right now. Portland Bible College, I really sense the faculty, God is setting you up for something new. You gotta feel it. You gotta sense it. You gotta see it. I really believe that God is doing something new. And I wanna say to you guys are gonna need new shoes for this new season, for this new race that God has in front of you. So get your new shoes because you're going to start running. You're going to start running and God will keep bringing the nations, but it'll be different. I just really sense something. Where are my international students? Guys, you've left home. And I know it hasn't been easy, and shoot, I get emotional. But can I tell you, there's a reward, and God has prepared something specific for you. Don't miss it in this season, because there's something so unique. The fact that the culture has changed, the fact that we have access to nations so easily, it's something different, and God has prepared you for such a time as this. So take advantage of this opportunity. I know there's a sacrifice, but there's also a reward. Amen? Let me pray over you. Father, we thank you right now for this season, God. And Father, I bless this morning TCKs. Father, I remove off of them any labels that were set on their hearts, minds, souls, God. And we declare your truth, your promises, your goodness to them. Father, right now, I pray for all my international students here, God. Father, I believe that you're calling them to a different season in their life. A different grace has been placed on them. A different vision has been given to them. So Father, I bless them this morning. I bless them, Father, and I believe for everything new that you would have for us, even as Manna House, as MCA, as PBC, Father, we receive it and we believe it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. And oh my goodness, my time. Okay, guys, I better jump in. Well, good morning. I am so glad I get to share this morning with you guys, and I do have a word that God gave me for this morning. But before I do that, if I haven't met you, my name is Miriam Trelease. You got to meet my niece who made me cry. And I came to Portland Bible College in the year 2000. And now I actually serve at Manna House as an executive pastor. I oversee international ministries for Manna House. But I also get to wear several different hats. My husband and I, who I honor, Ben Trelease, he's amazing. I got a great one, guys. I got a great one. But we get to serve as the Tigard campus pastors. I am also an MCA board member. I get to wear several hats around here. And I get to speak to you this morning. But I am 100% a product of PBC. I came in the year 2000, and I say, barely saved. By the grace of God, I ended up at Portland Bible College. And see, PBC became the catalyst that God used to transform me, to change me, to remove a lot of the negative stuff and sin that was in my life, and then to propel me to where I am today. And like I said, I get to wear several hats, and I've had many different titles at Manor House and PBC. But, you know, there's one title that's probably my favorite one, or at least, I mean, one of my favorite ones, and that is to be called Mommy by David and Marissa Trelease. Yep. Yep. Those are my babies. And I want to honor you, David and Marissa, because, see, they have been doing ministry with us since they were born. And they have encouraged me and enabled me to be a woman in ministry. Shoot. To be a woman in ministry, and for that, I thank you. Los amo. Okay, moving along, because I'm going to start crying and I can't handle this. But anyways, I'm so thankful for the opportunity. And today, I've been praying about this more than many other messages that I get to preach. Because I'm like, God, what do I say to them? What is something? And I thought about prayer, because prayer is one of my passions. But God said, no, not prayer. So today I'm going to share with you, with the time I have left, just a few phrases, practical phrases that have impacted my life, for sure, but also can shape you and mold you into becoming a better Christ follower. And we all need that, right? You know, for the longest time, I was fed up with making poor choices, dumb decisions. And I wanted wisdom, and because of that today, and because I know that high schoolers in Portland Bible College, you guys are in such a season that you're making decisions all the time that will affect the rest of your life. No pressure, right? But because of that, I just want to impart to you a very practical message. I mean, I leave the deep stuff to your teachers and faculty. I mean, you guys go for that. Today, I just want to give you just some practical probably three-liners, one-liners, that have really impacted my life. Why? Because I want you to learn, even from my mistakes, maybe, so you don't make those mistakes. I'm going to be talking to you probably as a mom more than anything else. But first phrase that I want to share with you this morning is that I came in 2000 from El Salvador to Portland Bible College, and I finally understood something, that church attender does not equal Christ follower. Church attender does not equal Christ follower. See, I wasted so much time playing the religious game. I did. I attended church, but I was not a Christ follower. Why? Because I wasn't willing to pay the price. See, I love the idea that Jesus would be my savior and my eternity was secure and I would be going to heaven. I love that thought of Jesus being my savior, but I was not too excited about him becoming my Lord, the Lord of my life. Why? Because when I did that, I needed to surrender to him daily. Not just one day that you pray something, no, but you surrender to him daily. And see, what's interesting is that I'm in a season of my life where people come to me and they ask me, how did you get to where you are? They ask me that. Honestly, I sometimes I'm like, I by the grace of God, and I don't know how I got to where I am. I am the first Latina elder that Manor House has had. You know, for many years, it was interesting because it was Glenda and me. And I would say, Glenda the legend, and then there's me. But God has given me that opportunity. So people ask me, how did you get to where you are? They absolutely ask me, how do I have the marriage that I have? And again, I got a good one, guys. My husband is, I got the best. I got the best husband. Apologize to everybody else, but I got the best husband. But see, when and I've had ladies come to me and ask me, how do you guys meet? And how did you guys start dating? And, you know, and I ask, you know, tell me a little bit about yourself. And so they start telling me what they're doing. And it never fails that they give me a list of qualities that they're looking for in a spouse. There's nothing wrong with that. I think it's a great idea. But they start, you know, listing things like, I just pray that they are passionate and devoted followers of Christ. And I'm like, that's really good. That's a great start. They're like, I hope they're financially stable. I mean, if they have a house, that's a bonus, you know? Well, I hope they treat their mom well, because if they do, that means they're going to be nice to me. Romantic, that's a great one too. So they start going through this list, and I'm thinking, oh, you want a max size combo. You know, you want the full combo. And I'm like, okay, I get it, yeah. But then the question is not, is he a combo, if I'm talking to a girl. The question is, are you a combo? Because the combo is not looking for a happy meal. Drop the mic and walk away, guys. We need to work on ourselves to become the combo. Because the combo that we're looking for is looking for another combo. Ain't looking for a happy meal. So how about we become a Christ devoted, surrender, Christ follower? I was in OT history, and I'll never forget that Ken shared something in OT history. He said, you know what? I wanted wisdom. And I'm like, Ken, you are the definition of wisdom. What are you talking about? But he said, I actually read a proverb every single day, according to the day. So today, the 17th, he would read Proverbs 17. And I'm like, I am grabbing that one, and I'm using it. And I did. And I mean, my husband and my daughter will not let me lie. I've done that so many times. Why? Because I need wisdom. If you lack something, ask God and he will give it to you. If you see things in your life that you need them to be removed from your life, ask God and he will show you a way. Why? Let me read. Got to read the Bible, guys. My time is running out. But James 1, verse 17 to 24 says the following. But don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you're only fooling yourselves. For if you listen to the word and don't obey, it's like glancing at your face in a mirror. You see yourself, walk away, and forget what you look like. Remember what Jesus said in Matthew 7:24? He said, therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. What does this mean? This means that you can have access to all the tools in the world. You can have access to hearing the word of God every single day through your teachers, through faculty. Every Friday, you have somebody coming and sharing the word of God to you guys. But what do you do with that? What do you do with those tools? Are you building? Because hearing is not the same as doing. Let me put it in just a few words here. They tell me that there are families, there are households that parents, not mine, parents walk into their kids' rooms and there's clothes everywhere. They're messy, not mine, other households, other families. But parents walk into the kids' rooms, and before they have a chance to say, hey, you need to clean, and the kids are like, I know. I know I need to pick up my clothes. I know I need to clean my room. I know it looks messy. And parents aren't even not even allowed to say anything else. But just because they know, it doesn't mean that the room is clean. Just because you know the word of God, it doesn't mean you're building on the rock. You know what? People don't change until they decide to change. That's a phrase that has marked me. I was not going to change until I decided that I was fed up with the way my life looked and I decided to change. That was a phrase that should be there. And I want to leave you with a practical, I have one more point, but I want you to think on this before I move to my next point. I want to leave you with a question. And the question is, what is one thing, don't think of the many things, but what is one thing you need to start doing or stop doing that you haven't been willing to do? One thing. I told you it was going to be really practical. What is one thing that the Spirit of God is speaking to you and telling you, you need to stop? See, you'll get to your destiny, your calling in God, but you might have to take a detour if you keep doing what you shouldn't be doing. You're not going to miss God's love or be pulled away from his love. You're not. But you're going to get a detour if you don't start doing the things that he's asking you to do. What is one thing? I ask myself this every single day. Hey, what's one thing that you need to start doing that you have not been willing to do? What is one thing that you need to stop, Miriam, that's not helping us? That I haven't been willing to do. Because see, I can tell you something. There's a notion, an idea that God just takes from us and he removes and he takes. Can I tell you something? Everything that God has taken away or removed from me has been for my benefit, not his. And sometimes we're not willing to surrender. We're not willing to let go. But everything that God has removed from my life, it has been for my benefit. Think of it like this. Isn't it the best gift? I mean, Christmas is coming, guys. But isn't it the best gift that we could give ourselves and those around us to be more like Christ? Because honestly, the decisions that we make don't only impact us, but they always impact the people around us, whether we are aware of it or not. But my decisions impact me and the people around me. So wouldn't it be the best gift this Christmas season that we become a little bit more like Christ? Okay, moving right along. Learn to love others the way they need to be loved, not the way we think we should love them. Yeah. John 13:34 says, A new command I give you. And they're all expecting to, Jesus, okay, what's new? What's coming? Okay, tell us, what's new? And he says, a new command I give you, love one another. And they're kind of like, isn't that kind of like what we've been taught all along? But look what he says. As I have loved you. Ooh, that's a different one. As I have loved you, you must love one another. Okay, MCA, PBC, how has God loved us? unconditionally and sacrificially. So that's a new command. So you mean that I need to lay down, deny myself, and then love others the way they will receive my love? Oh, so it's not just to think, but I love everybody, but are they receiving your love? Let me do something different here. A ver, ¿qué les parece si comienzo solo a hablar español? Y solo algunos de ustedes me entienden. ¿Cómo le va? Ah, ¿verdad que está bueno? ¿Verdad que sí? Y todos los demás perdidos. No, eso es injusto, sí. Regresemos a inglés. You know, guys, if I make a parallel between love and communication, you can understand this. See, I'm communicating to you, but you're receiving it because I'm doing it in English. But when I switch to Spanish, only those that were capable and had the ability and knew the language could receive it. And sometimes we believe that, but I love everybody, but are you demonstrating it in a way that they receive it? That's a big difference. Love your international students. I'm one of them, so that's why I get to say this. You know, I have the microphone now and I get to say that. But can I give you just a practical way in which you can love your international students, MCA and PBC? Hear their stories. Get to know them. You know, get over the fact that some of us speak with an accent. It's okay, we'll get by, we'll figure it out. But get to know them. I'll give a really practical one. Refresh your geography. See, when Jeff and Koya and Jason and Angie were sent to Southeast Asia, I actually had to learn, I'll admit it, I'm not perfect. I had to refresh my geography because I'm like, okay, where is Laos and where is Cambodia and, you know, okay, Southeast Asia, where's that? Yeah, I'm not too familiar with the map of Asia, but I wanted to know because I love them and I wanted to pray for them. So I became interested in where they were going. I'll give you fun facts right now. Below the south border of the U.S., there's 21 Spanish-speaking countries! 21! Not just one! We're not all from Mexico! Just a fun, practical way in which you can show love to others. Ooh, 4 minutes, okay. Very practical way in which you can love others, and I love that we prayed for the lost. Pray for the nations. If you're called to the nations, you should be getting involved. I mean, I love that at Manor House we have 3 Spanish services, we have Arabic gatherings, we have a Burmese campus, we have several international groups. Come talk to me. But pray for the nations. Pray for the lost. I feel that, you know, we're in a movement, Manor House. If you obviously attend Manor House, you've heard this. But as Manor House, we believe that we're a movement of disciples making disciples. But we got to start with the lost first. We have to start praying for the lost like we haven't, I believe. Let me share a little story. So my baby Marissa, she was 4 years old and David was 7. And we're a Disney family. We like Disney. So we decided to go to the happiest place on earth. We decided to go to Disneyland. And we're at Disneyland, having fun and everything. And suddenly, I'm like, Ben, is Marissa with you? And he's like, no, she's with you. And I'm like, no, she's not. Any parent will tell you that those are the longest seconds and moments of your life. And I remember like, okay, Marissa's 4 years old and I can't find her. And I remember I had the stroller And David started trying to say something to me. I'm like, sit down and shush. And he's like, I'm like, sit down. And honestly, guys, I started praying in tongues because in my spiritual heavenly language, because I didn't know how to pray in English or Spanish or the little bit of French that I know, I couldn't. So I went to my heavenly language. And I'm pushing Marissa in the stroller. And I'm sorry, David, thank you. Glad my husband is here to correct me. Help me out. But see, Ben, the calm one in the family, and he is, he stands on a garbage can and starts shouting Marissa's name. Disney does not like that. But he's like, Marissa! And suddenly we have a Disney crew member. Sir, please come down. We will help you. We will assist you, but please come down. But you know what, guys? The urgency that we felt and the need for us to look for our daughter should be the same urgency that we feel when we pray for the lost. It should be the same because that's how God feels. See, David could have said, Mom, I want a treat, I want a toy. And I would have been like, you know what, I love you, but no. Because one thing matters, finding the lost. And I think we need to bring that back to our prayer life. Because when my kids ask me for new shoes and they don't have new shoes, I buy them. But if they keep asking for new shoes when they have new shoes, I'm like, huh, wait. But if they say, Mom, my friend doesn't have new shoes, I am willing to give them the money because they're asking on behalf of somebody else. There's a different need. I'm not saying that God will not listen to our prayers. He does. I'm imperfect. I'm human. He's not. But there's something that happens in the heart of God when we go to intercessory prayer for the lost. We are loving the way He loves, and we're showing them what love is. Guys, I think my time is up, right? I can keep going. Oh, well. I skipped so much. You know what? Let's put into practice praying for the lost. What do you think about that? Can I ask you to stand and see? I forget his name, but he said, I want you to pray. Because praying for the lost, it's not something that I do from the front. If you're a Christ follower, intercessory prayer should be part of our prayer life. Pray for the nations too. The word says that it's that ask of God and He will give us the nations as our inheritance. I don't want to miss out on my inheritance. Are you praying for the nations? Are you praying for the lost? Are you loving people the way they need to be loved? Not the way we think we should love them. See, sometimes we think that Christianity is boring. Let me ask you something. When was the last time you led someone to the Lord? Because of the circles I've moved myself in, I don't get to have too many friends that are not Christ followers. But when I get to preach, and I preach in Tigard and I do it in our Spanish services too. And when I end the message and I invite somebody to become a Christ follower and they raise their hands, you know what I say? I always say, that's why we do what we do. And there's such an amazing feeling that makes it all worth it. But if you've never shared the gospel, if you've never led anybody to the Lord, maybe that's the one thing that you need to start doing. Because that will spark something in your spiritual walk. That will spark something. in your life, and it's not gonna be something boring. It's something that honors God and it brings fulfillment to you as a Christ follower. When was the last time you shared the gospel with someone? Let me pray for you guys. Father, I thank you for this morning. Jesus, I thank you for what you're doing in our hearts. Jesus, I thank you that you're so faithful, God, and you bring no condemnation. But Lord, I do pray that you would bring conviction to our hearts. Father, we want to be more like you, Jesus. It is a desire of our heart right now. Father, we pray that we would show more of Jesus to this world that desperately needs to see more of Jesus, God. Father, because we love the lost, because we care about the lost, we want to be Jesus to them. So Father, I pray right now that you would talk to people even right now specifically on things that maybe they need to stop today. Father, let there be a breakthrough today of things that are being laid down at the altar, God. And Father, I am calling out destinies and callings and people that have maybe forgotten that they have been marked for you, God. That they have been marked, that they are on mission here on earth to extend your kingdom, God. Father, let some of us even dust off promises and prophetic words that had been said and spoken over our lives and let them take life today, Jesus. Father, and I am asking you, Father, for us to have this awareness that the lost and the nations, they're so important to you and they should be important to us. Father, that your heart breaks for the lost. Father, let there be an urgency back and even in our prayer life that we pray constantly, daily for the lost. That our heart beats as your heart beat for the lost. And Father, I do pray right now for every nation represented here. Lord, thank you for what you're doing. And I do believe and sense that this is a new era, a new season for Manna House, for MCA, for PBC, God. Father, where you've brought the nations to us, Father, and we are called to be even missionaries here in the U.S., God. So Father, I pray that you would create a new awareness in us of how we are to bless the nations. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen and amen. God bless you guys.
Please give a joyful round of applause for Miriam. Muchas gracias, Miriam. Wow. International Chapel is coming to an end. And as a closing, we're gonna take picture. All internationals from PBC and MCA, and the rest of you, PBC can you're dismissed for lunch, and MCA, you're dismissed for leadership.
Unless you're international and would like to take a photo with us.
Yes.
MCA, please, we'd love to have you.
Let's go.
It's all internationals on stage.